if you can, we'd greatly, greatly appreciate it. All right, next up is our segment, Underrated or Jabated, which Gar's never been part of this one. So, Gar, this is where we usually have a couple cards, but today we only have one card. So we pick one card, and we basically make a classification. Is it underrated, or is it just, are we just getting jabated, you know, from it? And we try to pick a card that's kind of hard to tell, you know. This week I chose Bittertide Hydra, just because I've been trying it out in, like, Ramdrew, and just trying, like, just different things, oddball things, and seeing how it works. And, man, I'm starting to realize just how big the negative, the penalties that you take with Bittertide Hydra is every time, you know, Wild Pyro damages you one, or somebody pings you once with their mage, or anything like that, right? And or even Hunter with Unleash just decides to just run every one of their hounds into your Bittertide Hydra, and how crazy that is. But yeah, I want to get your thoughts. What do you think about Bittertide Hydra? Underrated or jabated?
I'm happy that you picked Bittertide Hydra as a card, because I was talking about this recently on my stream. I think this card specifically shows that Blizzard knows how to actually make good cards.
Yes.
I think this card is, like, perfectly designed. It is a very powerful card that you can play in aggro decks, but there's clear counterplay to it, right? You get super punished by Volcano, right? Volcano is the absolute prime example. You play Bittertide Hydra, yeah. I play Hydra, Volcano, you basically lose, right? So the way how you use it, it has to be very carefully chosen. You know, if you have two Hydras in your hand, or if you're too low on HP, that you just play your other cards. But it's obviously super powerful, but it gives, like, interaction to the, like, it really creates like a play between both players around that card. I think it's a very, very, okay, so underrated, I would say.
Okay.
I don't know if it's underrated because it's played in a lot of decks, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like, it's good. It's really good. I like it.
Yeah, it's definitely, like, really well-designed card. And the fact that it can actually give your opponent a win condition when they have no other win condition.
Yeah.
Like, you can be coming up to, like, there'll be some games where you, like, steamroll, and then you're like, oh yes, 5-8 on turn 5, let's close out the game. But then the closer games, it comes up to turn 5, and you're like, do I even play this? Like, I could...
It sits in your hand, right?
This could... You could be, like, slightly ahead, but then the only way you can actually lose a game is by playing the Hydra, and you don't play it. Like, it just makes you think. Like, most players think. It can, like, your opponent, like, when your opponent plays Bittertide Hydra, and you're like, well, can I actually find a way to win just by hitting his Hydra a lot of times, just ignore his face and literally just, like, freezing the Hydra and pinging it, for example, doing that loads of times. Mm-hmm. It's a really interesting card. And yeah, it's like, you can compare it to Fellreaver, right? The 5-8-8 mech that whenever you
burn three cards,
when your opponent played a card, it discarded three cards from your deck, which was definitely stronger than this, because you didn't care about cards being discarded from your deck. And so a lot of the time it didn't have a real downside, whereas this has a very kind of noticeable downside.
Yeah, I think to Gara's point, you know, this card does show that Blizzard's design of these cards that are low mana and hot, big bodies has improved, you know, whether it's Fellreaver or it's even 4-7/7. You know, the penalties just weren't quite deep enough, you know, or it wasn't tricky enough or immediate enough that the players had to navigate it. You know, they could just, like, oh, just throwing it down on curve, and that should be enough for me to finish the game. Now, like you said, it's an actual risk to actually put it on the board at any time, and you having to navigate that is where, you know, additional skill is involved. So that's really, really cool. It can be silenced too. You know, there still can be even interactions that you can synergize with it.
Like with Barnes, you pull it, like, it's played in silence priest as well. So there's so many things you can, even though the text doesn't look that crazy, there's so many things you can do. Like, both players can do with this card.
But make sure you don't Menagerie Warden it, guys, because that's what I was doing. And that was really, really bad. So, I think I'd give it an under. It's kind of tough because it's, like, it's underrated because of, I think, how well it's designed. But at the same time, it's a little bit jabated because it's an 8-8 body that can kill you. So it's somewhere in the middle. And I feel like that's a perfect card for this type of segment. The next up, we're going to do some Mechatorx Workshop, which I know a lot of you guys love. And Mechatorx is where we come up with our own custom cards, and it's a fun way for us to show some creativity from our patrons and some of our fans, as well as ourselves. Also, it's a way to give some ideas maybe to Blizzard if they're watching, like if they need any ideas, I don't know, whatever, right? So first off, we've got a card from Raydan, who's one of our patrons, and it is a... That's a rogue card, right? A 3-mana rogue spell. That's common card. It's fungal poison. Give your weapon +4 attack, and your spells cost 2 more. Okay, so your spells in your hand cost 2 more, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
That would be pretty crazy if all your spells cost 2 more.
Yeah, so I'm assuming when the weapon is destroyed, your spells go back to costing
normal mana. I think so.
I mean, giving your weapon +4 attack is pretty huge. A lot of the time, you are daggering on 2 as rogue, right? So you dagger on 2, then you use this, kill the Tar Creeper, then you have another. Like, I think
that's pretty good. I mean, is it better than 2 poisons? I mean, it's only one card. It's not better than 2 poisons, right? 2 poisons are only 2 mana, and you get more. You get the same.
Yeah, I mean, the issue is that rogue is generally so spell heavy, and your hand is very often just going to be a load of spells, and it's going to your spells costing 2 extra more is going to be a huge downside, and I would say it probably isn't worth the upside.
Okay, what do you think, Gara?
You would play this in aggro rogue, assassin's blade plus this and go face.
That's true.
Every turn.
That's true. That's probably true.
Easy. That would be a good card for aggro rogue, yeah.
I mean, yeah, if you're playing like a minion heavy, like pirate rogue maybe, like doesn't run really many spells at all.
What was the other card called that buffs a minion +4 attack? Yeah, the oil. It was 4 mana, right?
Yes, it was
4 mana. Yeah, 4 mana, give a minion +3 attack and three. +2 attack and your weapon plus.
It's +3 and +3, right? I thought it was both 3.
Yeah, yeah, +3 and 3.
+3, +3.
Yeah.
It's kind of similar a bit, but like a drawback. I do definitely play this in aggro rogue.
Yeah, there's definitely a drawback. I mean, at least the drawback requires you to do something in order, right? Yeah. Versus just like whatever.
Like you wouldn't play this in quest rogue or in miracle rogue. You need your spells to be cheap.
Yeah, yeah, that's true. Interesting card though. I do wish they would do something with weapons, with the rogue, and they do have Envenomous. I still think Envenom will be played at some point, but I don't know. Is it that they take too much damage?
Isn't it sad that they're going away from with Warrior as well, from like weapons? Focusing on weapons and go more on playing taunt minions? Like that makes really a lot of people like upset from what I've seen. It's just Warrior really represents like the class that just equips weapons, you know, and smacks the opponents.
Do you really want them to have more weapons? Really?
I mean, what about shield? Just think about it, introducing a shield card, not just a weapon card.
Okay, all right.
That reduces damage, you know, like let's say a shield that reduces damage 3 times by 2 or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah, there's just cool things you can do. Just spamming taunt minions, it's like it's another curve deck, you know, just spam minions. It's like there's so many decks of that sort.
Well, they were trying to make Protect the King something, right? And obviously that wasn't working. Bolster wasn't working. So they finally just said, screw it. We're just going to make super good taunt minions. And then that's our Protect the King. That's how we protect our king. But I know what you mean.
I don't think Pirate Rogue is that far off being a good deck.
No, I don't think so either. It's close.
Like if they had one or two cards that interact with the weapons, and you could play the Lucky Doo Buccaneer, which is, I believe it's a 6-mana 5/5 that gets +4/+4 if your weapon has 3 or more attack. And so it can basically be like the Draconid Crusher. Like people played that loads in like Pirate Warriors, like a 6-mana 9/9. And so if Rogue did have more weapon buffs, then I think that card could definitely see play.
It really always comes down to the, please let us have a balanced core set, right? Like, Druid and Warrior and Mage, those are like and Rogue are the only classes that have multiple viable archetypes, right? Compared to a Priest or Paladin or Hunter, just because their class cards are so much weaker.
Yeah.
Like Oryx is a good card.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Okay, well, let's move on to the next card, which is from Matt H. He actually has two cards that I wanted to show at the same time because he introduces a new keyword and a new concept that's called reinforced. And the reinforced keyword or this concept that he has involves how many unplayed mana crystals or unused mana crystals we have or the person that's playing this card has. And it affects like their opponent. So for example, he has a 5 mana. Actually, did we? Oh, yeah, I already talked about the other card. For this one, there's two cards, 5 mana, a 6/5 body, Agnes, the protected. It's a legendary card. It's a priest card. So it's a reinforced keyword. And it says enemy spells that target this minion must use additional mana equal to your unused mana crystals. So, an example would be this. If this is 5 mana, right? If I played this guy on turn 7 and I just purposely left 2 manas, wasted 2 mana crystals, my opponent would have to spend an extra 2 mana for any spells that he used on his turn. So it's basically using any of my wasted, it's a purpose for me to waste mana, where right now there's no purpose for you to waste mana. You want to use all your mana every single turn. So, so he has a priest card that does that. He has a mage card that's 6 mana. It's called Equalizer Gennadius. It's a 3/6 body, legendary, reinforced. Your opponent cannot play a minion with a mana cost less than your unused mana crystals. So yeah, what do you guys think about this? This is really different, right?
Yeah, this is a really kind of complicated and cool idea. Like, say the priest card, for example. Like, you can play it, like you said, on, say, turn 7, and then your opponent can't Phylon's Portlet. Mm-hmm. And I would say the effect is probably too niche. However, the stat line, it being a 6/5, like, it's not a terrible stat line. It's basically a...
It's a good stat line.
Would you purposely on turn 7, for example, just pass instead of using your hero power? Like, I mean, you would with this card, but
yeah, but that's how many point,
situations
right?
is it gonna? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's another situation where you just like, let's say you have control of the board, you don't use any mana on a single turn, and they're forced to either play a minion, or in the mage's case, they can't even play a minion, right?
Yeah.
So you play those type of turns, which is kind of crazy. You can only play Byroblast or something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
I think the flooding of mana is overrated. We could see this specifically when they introduced the priest legendary for Reno decks. The, what is it called? Erza, the 5 mana 5/5 that makes your hero power cost 0 mana.
Oh, yeah, Raza the Chained.
Yeah, because you thought, wow, I can just, and so I can use my mana for doing other things. And in the end, nobody even played that card in
Arena.
Oh,
you're talking
priest.
About the, what's her name? The legend where you, that turn, you you can cast any spell basically, right? For nothing.
No. The 5 mana 5/5 that makes your hero power cost 0 if your deck is
Raza.
Okay. That's Raza, but how does that save your?
Like, it's like it didn't matter if your hero power costed 0 or 2. It's like you felt like, oh my god, now I have like 2
okay.
extra mana.
I see what you mean, right?
And then it's like people just it looked greater on paper than it was in reality. I think it is similar with these cards that you basically want to still curve out, right? The goal is to just not flood mana. And so you would want to play a good card for 5 mana on turn 5, let's say Draconic Operative, and then play like a good card on turn 6. Like, you don't want to play a bad card like off curve, if that makes sense. So your opponent has, and a lot of the removal cards are usually very cheap as well. It's like in Hearthstone, like every removal card, Hex, Shadow of Death. For example, if you play this on 5, my Shadow of Death costs 5 mana, right? But I can still kind of death it on curve. Yes, it's a little bit more expensive, but I can still remove it, right? It's not really like... Right now, we have like so powerful cards that give me something strong on the board, but give me an additional like value or a crazy benefit, like operate, for example. Like I have a 5-mana 5/6, which is arguably stronger than 5-mana 6/5, but it gives me a card from your deck that's like incomparably much stronger than just having a small like downside of you removing this card. It's, we have more broken cards pretty much. But the idea is super interesting, yeah, for sure. But I think it has to be a little bit more broken for this to see play, you know, just to compete with the other existing cards.
I think it's a great concept. I think definitely. I think it's an additional complexity to Hearthstone that a lot of us would like to see, at least a lot of the people that follow competitive scene and things like that would like to see, just because, you know, Hearthstone at times can seem very linear, can, you know, some of the skill cap to it, it seems to be, you know, limited to an extent. And this adds like an additional level of complexity to it where you have to think through even more turns. Now, that's probably one of the reasons why they'll never add it too, just because it's too complicated.
Yeah,
but that's, you know, like it, hopefully we'll get to a point where something like this can be accessible, you know, like where...
I mean, there are some absolutely crazy things you could, like, take the Mage card, for example. If you were to play that and, like, have leftover mana against a deck like Quest Rogue, and then they just can't play any minions, and they don't have any removal in their deck, so
you just kill them,
you would just win the game on the spot by like by having mana over with
is it just for the turn you play it or forever?
I think it's forever, right?
It's
is it like a battle cry?
I thought it was like while it's on the board.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's not
then, while then it's on the just... board. Yeah.
Okay, if it's a win condition against Grimstroke, then it's a...
it's not like we don't have decks right now that are absolute 100% win conditions against other decks like Jadruid, awesome. Right? So
I think the Mage one is would be a lot more likely to see play than the Priest.
Yeah, that Mage card, like aggro decks can't play cheap minions.
Yeah.
It's like you play this on 6, they can't play cheap minions anymore. Rip Totem Shaman.
Oh yeah.
That's crazy. That card is amazing.
imagine if it's Priest versus Mage and they both have this minion on the board. They both have their own minions on the board, so the Mage can't cast spells.
But that's bad in a way, right? If the opponent can't do anything anymore, like that's like it would be maybe fun for the guy who plays the card, but for the opponents, like you can't be that limited.
Talk about non-interactive.
Yeah, it'd be very uninteractive.
It's very
one-sided.
I can't
interactive.
Play a card. I guess I lost.
I mean, you can use spells. You can use spells.
Well, if you're the priest. not if you use the priest card, then you can't use spells, right?
That's only, you can only use spells on the target, on that minion, right? It's not in general.
So aggro decks will have to play Dirty Red.
You're right. It's only targeting that one, okay. That's true. Oh yeah, the Mage one's much better. That's true.
Yeah, the Mage one is.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot for sending those, at least that card in, Matt. But Jackie's got a card here too, which I'm gonna bring up.
Yeah, mine's a lot less, lot less exciting.
is it the one that we talked about? Ideas, but okay.
It's like a Volo class card here for turn.
It was yeah, pretty much.
No way.
It's very close to that.
Okay, let me do this. Sorry. This is a 4-mana warlock card, 3/5 demon, cruel medic rare, battlecry, deal 4 damage to your hero. Death rattle, restore 8 health to your hero. Okay. All right, talk us through that, man. Talk us through this.
I mean, I think, like, eventually, I think there does need to be some kind of good... Like, there does need to be some kind of heal in Warlock. Whether it be... they're not going to get anything like Antique Healbot that's insane, but maybe some kind of heal where there is a downside. So this is obviously, like... It's going to be pretty bad against aggro. Like, you're just dropping this on turn 4, and you're just damaging your face. It's not that great stat line, and it's not really doing that much. Whereas in the long run, you're getting kind of, you're essentially getting a 3/5 that restores 4 health. So it's kind of similar to Jinyu, but with like an immediate downside.
Okay.
What is interesting is that Warlock never used a class card that healed it himself. They always used neutral healing. Healbot, Reno, Farseers,
I mean, they have stuff available, right? But they just don't
like Siphon Soul. But it was always like kind of sack pack damage heal a little bit related, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like the free mana card was like really bad, the drain life.
Right.
But
drain life.
It's kind of interesting.
Yeah, but, I think it's pretty cool. Yeah, I think I'm gonna. I wish I would have made one that was similar, because I think that damaging your hero, there are not enough cards that reward a warlock for damaging himself. Yet there are a lot of cards that damage themselves, right? Like there's Life Tap. There's there's probably four or five cards that damage a warlock right now, and it would be cool if there was just more advantage. You know, we used to have, what was the minion that buffed itself every time you damaged yourself?
The 5-mana 4/4 dude, yeah.
Yeah. Right, yeah, right? Yeah, he was good way back. What was that? What was the name of that card? Oh my gosh. It would be nice if we could see a card like that again.
It's cards that are like synergy cards with some sort. This is like a synergy card, right?
Yeah.
Whenever you damage yourself, or cards with a great benefit after completing a synergy, right? They have to be good, like viable.
Great.
And drawback cards as well, like the Hydra. It's cool to see both ways, right? Very powerful synergy cards. So you have to do something, like collect multiple cards that you get a good benefit. Like this, you could combine with the Urza, or is it Urza that procs a Death Rattle minion, like the legendary?
Oh, Umbra.
Yeah, Umbra. I thought you were thinking about that. So you can run multiple Death Rattles in Warlock and then just heal yourself, you know, just for 8, bam, then you get another plus 8 heal. Stuff like that. It's really
And cool. I was kind of thinking about Nuzzoth a little bit, because like Nuzzoth, like you have Mistress of Mixtures, which is literally one of the best healing cards for Warlock, and then like this would be good as well.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. It's just because Warlock. Like they have cards like Fellfire Potion, which is like compared to like Dragonfire Potion. Dragonfire Potion's like one of the best AoEs in the game. Warlock has basically the same thing, except you do 5 damage to your face, and you, because there's no healing, you just can't play that card.
Mm-hmm. All right. I guess the real question is just, can it afford another spot that just incrementally heals them? You know, versus a lot. 4 is a decent amount though. If it was 3, it'd be harder for me to justify that, but the body itself isn't going to really sustain for very long in the current meta. Maybe against shamans, okay? It forced at least some kind of removal, for it force him to have a flame tongue totem or something like that. But
I think if you give Warlock a good healing card, it would just get completely abused.
Yeah, absolutely.
And be like the OPs. I think if they do print a Warlock healing card, it would have to be kind of along these lines where it is.
Yeah.
Dodgy.
Yeah, exactly. Good dodgy. That's a good way to describe it. All right. Well, great card there. And again, thanks to everybody that wrote or at least sent in their Mechatorch Workshop card. If you want to, if you're a patron, patrons get first priority, obviously. If you want to write in or send us some of your own card ideas, you can go to Hearthstone or hearthcards.net and make your own cards and send them to us. You can email those to valuetown@chainmanv.tv. And we'll take a look at them and try to find the best, 4 or 5 of them that we can each week. All right. We've got some email questions too, which you can email those also at valuetown@chainmanv.tv. Also, you know what? Another thing with the Q&A for each episode, you can actually come to the Discord too and ask them, especially in the Hearthstone channel. Maybe I'll make a Valuetown Q&A channel soon. Go to discord.gg.chainmanv and you can see the channels. And that's going to be another outlet for you to ask questions. All right, first one is Davin P., who's a patron. Last Brawl was the worst yet. Yes, let's start off with some positivity here. Batches equals 99.99% win. So if you, and just for those of you wondering what he's talking about, the last Tavern Brawl, you chose one card that you know, it's like a one card meta where you got 22 of those cards, and then you would get 8 class cards, I believe, and you would just battle, you know, whoever it was. So a lot of people picked patches. You know, patches obviously was a good choice, given that you can just keep summoning 2 patches and that sort of thing. If you were to suggest a new Un'Goro themed brawl, such as Rag versus Nox, which legendary NPCs would you like to see? Would it be a dual or a co-op Explorers? Okay, all right. So, which two, I guess, here characters would I
would choose? I would say Yogg and Noggenfogger, and it would just be a complete RNG fiesta, but Yogg was obviously not from Unguro. So instead, I'll go with Swamp King Dread against King Mosh.
Ooh, dinosaur. That's a good choice. Fight. Good choice. How about you, Gara? Yeah.
Boy, that's a tough one. Like a cool. I would have went for the Yogg as well, right? it sounds crazy.
I'm trying to think of what the legends are right now. It'd have to be like dinosaur versus dinosaur, right?
Or elemental. Osrock or Calamos or something.
Yeah, Calamos versus.
Or you could have elementals versus dinosaurs, and you have.
Okay,
like,
there we go.
Osrock and Calamos against King Mosh and Queen Carnassa.
What's the biggest? Is it the druid dinosaur that is the biggest one?
Wait, are we talking Tyrantus here?
Tyrantus?
Tyrantus.
Versus Calamos.
Tyrantus versus Calamos, man. That's like Godzilla versus... what's an elemental? What's an elemental kind of anime manga type of thing? Is there an elemental monster being in those Japanese films? I don't even remember.
Maybe not.
Yeah, that'd be pretty cool. Tyrantus versus... I like the Dread versus Mosh, though. That's a good one. It's like watching Jurassic Park, the latest Jurassic Park, right? Jurassic Park. I'm getting my dinosaur terms all messed up. Where they had the Tyrannosaurus Rex, the original T-Rex versus the new T-Rex. Did you see that? Did you guys ever see that in the movies? No. There was like a modified T-Rex versus the old T-Rex from the old
that
movies.
Was cool.
Yeah, that's kind of crazy. All right, so next question we got from Matt H is a pretty long one. But try to summarize a little bit. I would like to present some thoughtful opposition to a common thread I've picked up over the past weeks across two or three Hearthstone podcasts. This is the notion that Hearthstone is too expensive. I'm a casual, mostly a free-to-play player. Based on that, I limit monetary investment to only new expansion releases while the discount is in effect. That said, I've played for a while now and have close to a full collection. On the whole, I haven't found it difficult to have most of the best cards because the best cards are no more expensive to craft than any of the other cards in the same rarity. For this reason, net decking will always be so pervasive because it's not hard enough to acquire all the cards in many of the top decks. I am therefore concerned about the new policy to eliminate duplicate legendaries. So this is completely opposite, right, of what everybody's saying, that it raises the odds of opening the key legendaries and means that we will be selling even more of the current cancer decks in the meta. If it were up to me, packs would be more expensive, and I would love to see Blizzard implement a new rarity class that is offered at a significantly lower rate compared to legendaries. That would also be totally uncraftable. Ideally, this would be built around cards that would not serve as simply a way to enhance already polished decks, but to instead provide another way to inject more variety into the meta. Okay, so this is a total counter-argument to the whole just no duplicate legendary change being a positive. And it sounds like he wants to get to the point where there are cards that people don't have, and that's just how it should be, you know. And it can even get to the point where we have like super rare cards that just pop up maybe like one every 20,000, and only some people have it, right, and others don't. So what do you guys think about that?
I mean, I think there are cards that people don't have. Like, I play Hearthstone pretty much every single day of my life, and I've spent a lot of money on Hearthstone as well, and I still don't have anywhere near all the cards, and I don't have any golden cards either, because I used to be a free-to-play player. Like, I used to never want to play, like, before I became like a professional streaming player, I would never want to spend money on the game. I would just kind of grind away through Arena trying to get gold, and it's only when I became a streamer that I started like doing pack openings and stuff like that. But I think that like giving people more kind of making cards easy to get means that instead of basically he's saying kind of the flip way of how I think it. He's kind of saying that it's easy to get the popular legendaries, and so more people will play the best decks. I kind of think of it the other way, where it's people get the best legendaries first, and then if they have more gold or dust, then they have more freedom to get the more quirky legendaries and try different things.
Oh wow.
Yeah. And that's the way I would think of it. And I think
so many people ask always, like in comments, like what is the first legendary I should craft, right? Yeah. And they usually craft patches or like a legendaries for a tier one deck, and then they don't have the legendaries even for the fun decks.
Yeah. And I mean, it doesn't have to be a fun deck, right? I think it's more like, you know, trying to mix and match stuff, and that's going to happen more likely, obviously, in lower levels and in more of those casual ranks than at the top. But to Jackie's point and to Gar's point, that's what people do. People want to be efficient with their way of playing Hearthstone most of the time. So they'll craft a tier one deck and try to get as many wins so that they can get more gold and they can buy more cards and packs and things like that. So I know where he's going with that. And like from a competitive level, I don't think we can do that. Like you have to have I feel like you should have an even playing field whenever you're talking about like a pro scene for Hearthstone.
Like as a good player, you always expect your opponent to have all cards when you kill leather. Like you never go with the mindset, oh, maybe my opponent doesn't have, you know, patches in his Pirate Warrior. Right? You always expect your opponent to have the best deck, pretty much.
Yeah.
But another thing is definitely Hearthstone, also in my opinion, is way too expensive. But come on, man, it's 2017. Microtransactions, that's what we need, dude. It's like no fun to spend money on Hearthstone, right? It's so, I feel like it's, for all the other games I'm playing, it's so much more fun to spend money on, because you get cool stuff for your money. In Hearthstone, it's just packs, you know? It's kind of boring, I don't know, just buying packs and then...
But what could you do, Gar? Like what?
Like, a lot of cool things, like boards, you know?
Okay.
Like sounds, different, like, oh, the same...
Sounds?
Like, sound
packages are definitely something, yeah.
Dude, Blizzard is known for the most epic gaming soundtrack out of all games. Like with World of Warcraft, Warcraft 3, Warcraft 2 and everything. And in Hearthstone, we have the same stupid Tevin sound for 3 years, dude. It's triggering me so hard. Like, why do we not have, like, different music, like, in Hearthstone? I don't get it. Like, Blizzard is really known for, like, epic orchestra and whatnot.
They could make
there's
new
so many things. Different heroes. There's so many different heroes. Like, I don't know, silver cards instead of golden cards. And this is super things. Yeah, what? Like... Why
it's
not?
True.
Like,
you could just do so many, like they can do so many random things.
50 deck slots. I don't care.
Like, 50 deck slots.
Yeah,
I mean, one thing I would
do. Do you know how long it takes to get 18, man?
People love spending money on that stuff.
One thing I would disagree with is when you said opening packs is boring. I think opening packs is boring for a professional player because you do have to have all the cards and you kind of need the cards.
Yeah,
but when you're a player who doesn't have many cards and they're kind of like, oh, I really want to get this card, then pack opening is pretty exciting.
For them, I guess for them it's more frustrating when you open the same legendary like four times in a row. It should be more.
That's not
going to
happen anymore. Yeah, that's definitely not going to happen anymore.
I think it's a good change.
Yeah. So overall, I do wish that there was a sense of there were these type of rarities, but it's not so much the cards themselves. It's just like the foil around them, that there is still some kind of impressiveness that you could have where it's uncraftable. But in terms of the actual cards and, you know, having the utilities and, you know, as tools and stuff, I don't think that the player should be, you know, it's that separate. Like, there shouldn't be a guy that has the most powerful card in Hearthstone and nobody else has it. Therefore, he's the world champion. You know, that should never happen. You know, that's just not a good
thing. It's like this, you remember the starter pack with one legendary and five packs or something?
Yeah.
That was super cheap. Stuff like this has to happen, like, on a regular basis.
Yeah, I think it
you
will.
You know, this,
I think it's
this discount combos where you get, like, three legendaries and a bunch of packs.
Volcanosaur. Yeah. I mean, Volcanosaur, that day before the expansion last for Un'Goro,
That was
a fun day. I mean, all of you guys were streaming.
Everyone
crazy.
Played it.
Yeah.
It was
crazy
so bad,
fun
it.
Decks, man. It was awesome.
Need that. We so need that. Stuff like that.
I know. Ever since then, Volcanosaur has not been touched.
imagine for YouTube content, if you get one card, you know, per week. For me, for example, I make YouTube content since the beginning of time. And now it's so stale, like you can't make deck tech videos because it's like the same meta decks, you know. It's like you want to make a Warlock deck, but when you make a video about that, it's usually a bad deck with a very bad win rate, and then you feel bad about posting it. And
you know what? Igara, this gives me an idea like that's going to actually be the genesis is going to be right here at this moment on this show, or at least one for a segment that we're going to do. I think maybe Jackie or throw out there. Why don't we do this? Why don't we, for next week, we pick a card, and Gar, we'll let you pick the card. We pick a card, and we let you guys build a deck. Pretend everybody gets this card free for a day, and we'll let you guys build, like, the best deck. And we're going to pick the best deck that somebody submits to us. So, and just kind of show it off, and obviously, you know, hopefully have them be proud that we picked their deck. So what card would that be, Gara?
So it has to be, I have to like check the...
So we have to build, basically we're all going to be set a challenge to build a deck around one specific...
Including all the listeners too, Okay. We'll pick a listeners deck, and then we, you know...
But it has to be an Un'Goro card that is not in one of the top meta decks right now.
It has to be not played, and it has to be...
Yes, please don't pick Stonehill Defender.
Somewhat iconic, so some kind of like theme or something so that you can build around it.
Yeah. So we'll definitely give you a second to do that. And while we're doing that, I'll just give a quick reminder that we are doing a deck of the week each week for Valuetown. You can actually find the deck of the week on the Patreon site. So patreon.com/Valuetown. And it's public to everybody. The only thing that we tried to make special for our patrons is that our patrons are our guests on that mini show that we do every Monday. And what we do is we just share our experiences with that deck. We play it all week and compare winning percentages and maybe some of the big elements and tips that we've kind of come to learn through losing or just as we've been playing the decks. A lot of times Jackie's played the decks a lot, so he just gives us tips most of the time. But yeah, that's been a lot of fun, and I think a lot of the patrons have been really enjoying it, and I know a lot of other folks that aren't patrons also been really appreciating it. So yeah, if you can partake, definitely go check that out. And we always just do the mini show on Discord. It's just an audio only thing that we make public. You can listen to some of them too if you go to that page. They're public too to everybody. So yeah, deck of the week is always really, really cool. Just another thing that we've been starting up doing with Valuetown. You picked the card yet, Gara? I'm like trying to kill time here, dude.
Get on with it, Gara, Jesus.
I give you four cards, and you choose one of them. Cards that I really like. One is Jungle Giants. Great quest.
All right.
Swamp King Dread.
Swamp King Dread, yes, I like that.
Yeah, the Hunter Legendary. Dino-Size.
Yes, Dino-Size.
Okay.
And the Molten Blade. Is it four or five cards? Yeah, one of them.
Sure. Molten Blade.
Which one would you
do? What do you think?
Not Swamp King Dread and not Molten Blade.
Okay.
So Jungle Giants, Dino-Size.
I would say Jungle Giants.
Jungle Giants is going to be more interesting than Dino-Size. Dino-Size, you can literally Dino-Size anything. Like, I don't know if there's really much building around with Dino-Size.
Yeah, because on my quest list, power level, I think Jungle Giants was like the fifth worst quest. So it's like middle field. It's kind of like on the verge to be like, okay.
It is middle of the... Like, I have played it quite a lot, and I think it's the most underrated quest. It's not one of the best. It's not one of the best quests, but it's also not one of the worst. It is, like you said, kind of in the middle.
Surprisingly not hard to complete. It's just you can't complete it fast, obviously. So, okay, let's do that. Jungle Giants, guys. Druid quest. I know a lot of you guys might not have it, unfortunately, because that is not one of the quests I'm sure you guys try to craft, right? But if you guys want to partake, or you can actually just build a deck even without playing it. But build the deck, submit it to us, send it to us, valuetown@chanmanv.tv, and we will pick whose deck that we think is going to be the greatest. We'll come up with a name for it. But we can thank Gara for this idea, I guess, as to having you guys build decks for us. All right, well, why don't we wrap up? It's a great show. Gara, I know you got to get back and get some workout done or do some workouts before you get on to, continue the Iron Man of Hearthstone title and role that you have. But you want to do any shout-outs right now? Where can people find you?
To my Twitter, @TempoGara, and to my YouTube channel, GaraBestShaman. I do a lot of content, and obviously my stream, twitch.tv/GaraBestShaman. Shout out to my team, Tempo Storm. I'm there with them for a very, very, very long time. Hopefully for another very, very, very long time to come. very happy. especially with Reynard, it's so cool to have like a boss that is like, so like we're like friends, mm-hmm. and it's like a very cool relationship. And yeah, I'm very happy. And that's it.
I still remember when he found you, man. I still remember when he found you way back when, man.
Oh, that's so dope. That
yeah,
so dope.
Yeah, I remember that. That was awesome, dude. Oh, of course, man. Then, yeah, of course, it's been great having you on. And again, like, it's been way too long since we've had you. So I'm glad that we got a chance to figure out a good
time. Just, I have to win something, a major again, and then
invite me. Like, have to. Oh, that's what I mean.
What's up?
I mean, you don't have.
I'm like, hey, Jamie, what's up?
We talked about having you on, actually, a couple weeks ago. It's just, we've been going through, like, this host change. That's why it's been a little bit.
This is actually a very good time slot for me now.
Okay.
With my schedule.
Awesome. Sounds good. All right, Jackie, shout outs.
Yeah, check out my Twitter, F2K_Jackie. I mean, this has been streamed on my channel, Jackie Chan. I stream like pretty much every day.
Be sure to sub and use your Twitch Prime subs on this channel and follow.
Yeah. And thanks, Chanman, as usual, for hosting this show. It's really good to have kind of joined the team. And it's a lot of fun. And thank you to all our patrons who support us. And, keep us going, keep us strong.
That's right. And for those of you wondering where Allie is, she's actually in Shanghai with a bunch of the some other personalities that are hanging out for the expansion announcement. So she'll be back. She'll give us the lowdown on everything at HCT in Shanghai and all that fun stuff. So she'll be back next week. But I do want to give a quick promo of Streamer Showdown this Friday. We're going to be, people are wondering when we're going to do the next one. Well, yep, it's going to be this Friday at 2 p.m. Eastern. For those of you wondering what Streamer Showdown is, it's the game show that I do with Vindexus. And, we have different editions, but the Hearthstone edition, obviously, is the one that you guys care about. And it's going to be Noxious hosting, of course. And then it's going to be Dog, Tice, and then Jackie. It's going to be the third.
That picture here. Looks nothing like me.
I know. You need to get a better picture, dude. You totally need to get a better picture.
I don't take pictures, man. Pictures
Jackie looks like the most dangerous opponent.
He does, doesn't he?
I don't want to face this.
That's awesome. Man. So yeah, okay. Definitely check that out. It's going to be on Tice's channel, twitch.tv/Tice, T-H-I-J-S-H-S on Friday. And if you haven't watched in the past, we've had a great time. We do all kinds of segments, trivia, Family Feud, Pictionary, emojis, dank memes, you name it. And we've got a new game segment this week that we're going to be introducing, so you guys are going to definitely want to check it out. Very, very Hearthstone specific, so I'm sure you guys will love it. On top of that, follow me on Twitter at ChainManV. Follow the show on Twitter at ValueTownGG, and you can find all the shows on YouTube.com/ChainManV. All the episodes, past episodes, and then this one will be posted a little bit later. Also, iTunes, just to remind you, on audio as well as Google Play. Find us, leave reviews. Let people know, because we're trying to build up that audio audience a little bit more too. But that's going to be it, guys, for Value Town this week. So for Gara, Jackie Chan, and ChainManV, we will see you next time. Later. Yeah.